Hello and welcome to Who Wore It Better, where I review Raw and Smackdown back to back and try and figure out which show won for the week. Well, it's go home week for the new pay-per-view Stomping Grounds, where you can kick names and take ass, or something like it. Raw begins with Elias in the ring. He's wearing a referee's shirt, and after dissing new LA Laker Anthony Davis and the city of Los Angeles in general, he announces he's going to be the guest referee for that Baron Corbin-Seth Rollins match at the pay-per-view, after which he's immediately beat up from behind by Seth Rollins and a steel chair. Rollins says this is everyone's first and last warning to anyone who's considering taking that referee spot at Stomping Grounds. After Rollins leaves the ring, The Miz comes out for his match up next. He picks up Elias, hits him with a skull-crushing finale, and you can kind of see where this is going from here. Bobby Lashley comes out, hits Elias with a spear. I thought they were friends now since they were both heels. Cesaro comes out, hits a giant swing. Ricochet with kind of a codebreaker move on Elias. Then finally, Braun Strowman comes out and offers him a warm hug and a hearty handshake. Just kidding, a running power slam. You know, I mean, I don't know who Elias pissed off for that segment, but it was pretty funny to see him just get beat up one by one by one. We then go to our first match of the night, a fatal five-way between all those aforementioned guys, where the winner becomes the new number one contender to Samoa Joe's U.S. title. Early in the match, Cesaro with a really impressive pickup of Braun Strowman onto his shoulders, kind of like a torture rack position, then slams him down. It's too bad it means nothing because Strowman no-sold it, eliminated Cesaro right afterward. Braun then eliminates Bobby Lashley. Lashley and Cesaro get back into the ring to beat up Strowman and help Ricochet eliminate Braun after a 630 and an assisted pin. Strowman gets revenge on all three of those guys. It's still down to Ricochet and The Miz for the final two. After a few minutes, Ricochet ultimately wins the match by hitting Miz with a 630, a second one of the night, and so he's going to go on to face Joe for the title at Stomping Grounds. After the match, Joe tries to jump Ricochet, but it backfires and Ricochet stands tall in the end. The Raw Women's Champion Becky Lynch shows up for a face-to-face with Lacey Evans. Before she comes out, though, they show a picture of her and her boyfriend, Seth Rollins, on the red carpet at the MTV Movie and TV Awards. I don't know how to feel about the company making this big deal about their relationship. Like, it's not beating you over the head with it, but you do see them on screen a lot together, and they'll say, oh, they're dating. I just dread the day they eventually turn that into like a full-blown storyline. Anyway, Lacey Evans comes out, and she provides some background on herself. She brings up the fact that she is a Marine, and Becky says, you know, I respect what you were, but I don't appreciate what you've become. Lacey Evans talks some more trash. She's about to get in the ring, but Becky just hits her and brings her in the ring, hits her with a Beck Exploder, and stands tall. So it's kind of Becky's thing these days, where in lieu of a snappy comeback, sometimes just beating them up will do. And that's pretty much how the segment ends. Probably their strongest interaction they've had to date. After that, we get this very interesting long shot that takes place like from the crowd area. It pans over from the ring to the backstage area. It walks past some local workers as security guys. I recognize Mikey O'Shea and Eric Watts among those guys. Good to see y'all on TV. Then we see The Revival walking into Shane McMahon's VIP lounge, where they join Shane and Drew McIntyre, and they have some bubbly together. Yeah, we'll be seeing a lot more of these guys in the VIP lounge as the night goes on. It's backstage Baron. Corbin's being interviewed and says he will reveal his pick for guest referee later tonight on the Kevin and Sammy show. He is then promptly won from behind by Seth Rollins and his trusty chair. Seth Rollins is taking no BS tonight. He's not suffering fools gladly on this night. The SmackDown Tag Team Champions are on loan for the evening. Daniel Bryan and Rowan make their way to the stage, and Daniel cuts a promo healing not just on Raw, but all the city of Los Angeles, a recurring theme on the night, if you haven't noticed. And so he says he will excite the people of Los Angeles by beating up Seth Rollins in the main event. The Viking Raiders interrupt. The two teams have a stare down before the Viking Raiders go and have their match with local talent Russ and Randy Taylor, who they destroy within seconds. After the match, we get a crowd shot of a bunch of people all booing and giving the thumbs down. I had no idea the Viking Raiders were heels. But then we see very poorly disguised R-Truth and Carmella just sitting right there in the front row. I love the fact the camera pans past them and goes, Red snaps right back. Wait a minute. What are these guys doing here? And sure enough, the League of Jobbers come running after them and they run away. If you're trying to be hiding, why would you sit in the front row? Why would you be there at all? Why not just sit in the cheap seats if you're going to have to be there? Back at the VIP lounge, we see Heath Slater enter, and he's talking to Shane, but we can't hear anything because there's audio issues. Michael Cole's trying to narrate over it to try and tell people what's going on. Luckily, the audio does recover, and we hear Heath trying to ask Shane for a raise. Shane says no, but you know what? You came in here like a man, so I'll let you walk out like one. After he leaves, Drew McIntyre's former brother-in-arm with 3MB comes out and says, you know, let me try and help you. He tries to offer him some money, and Heath is like, no, don't do that. The money gets dropped. Heath goes to pick it up, and Drew just beats the shit out of Heath Slater for his troubles and everything, just whomping on him. The Revival break it up, and my favorite part is when the Revival pick up up the money and Heath's phone, because he was on the phone with his wife when Drew came into the shot. I just love the fact that Revival just straight up took Heath's phone. It's time for the Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn show with special guest Baron Corbin. Kevin and Sami both withdraw their names from referee contention for Stomping Grounds. Then Baron introduces his pick for referee. It's EC3, and he's there on stage for all of 10 seconds before Seth Rollins whomps him from behind with a steel chair. And that's pretty much that. And Corbin just goes, well, back to the drawing board. Then we have this awkward pause where he looks up at the stage, waiting for some cue to happen. And sure enough, the New Day interrupts. So Kofi and Xavier and Big E are all there. And Kofi says he can go where he wants to because he's the champion, baby. Corbin then challenges the New Day to a six-man tag team match because, of course, it's time for one. And so then the guys pick up an unconscious EC3 who's wearing the referee's shirt. So they do some ventriloquism with him to make the match officially sanctioned, even while he's knocked out. That's probably the most entertaining EC3 has been the entire time he's been on the main roster. Before that match, though, we get a shot of the trainer's area, and you know it's the trainer's area because in the establishing shot, the camera's moving around and you see posters of charts and graphs and things. So AJ Styles is talking to the trainer. In walk Gallows and Anderson, AJ's old Bullet Club buddies, and they're dressed in the lab coats, very similar, kind of a throwback to when they were feuding with the New Day a couple of years ago, like in their first year of the company. And so AJ basically gives them this big pep talk saying, don't be these silly characters, don't be these weird guys, just be the killers that you were in Japan, and that's going to help hopefully motivate them for their match later on. We then go to that six-man tag match up next as the New Day take on Baron Corbin, Kevin Owens, and Sami Zayn, and it's been announced now a 2 out of 3 falls match. Nice change of pace. The New Day win the first fall after Xavier rolls up on Sami. We get Corbin accidentally clotheslining Sami near the end. Kevin Owens, who sees all this, by the way, and he gets right into Baron's face, hits him with a super kick, and then walks away. Why would he be so upset about that? He's acting as if, like, oh, I can't believe you intentionally hit Sammy, even though I saw clear as day you didn't mean to hit him. So anyway, Corbin's left high and dry. Kofi hits the Trouble in Paradise on Corbin to win the match, so the New Day win 2 falls straight. Yeah, real nice look for the guy who's fighting in what's presumably the main event of your pay-per-view on Sunday. After a backstage bit where Alexa Bliss tells Nikki Cross she secured a women's tag title match for them later in the night, Paul Heyman's in the ring, and he opens up by vehemently rejecting the notion that he would possibly be the guest referee for Sunday. Then he makes a big analogy between Seth Rollins and the LA Lakers. Lots of ball references in his promo here. It makes a lot more sense if you follow the NBA, which I do kind of a very tiny amount. Then he basically warns Seth Rollins that Brock Lesnar could show up at any time, anywhere. Ooh, spooky. It was a very solid promo by Heyman. It's even more so if you understand the basketball reference he's making. We get another dramatically lit Usos promo backstage. We also see Baron Corbin having a chat with Eric Young about the referee position. You can see Eric kind of thinking about it as he walks off. He runs into Seth Rollins, lies about it, then gets the shit beat out of him by Seth and his trusty chair. You know, it's not much, but it's still cool to see EY. We then go to the Usos versus the Good Brothers in tag team action for a relatively short TV match. It's very entertaining and very exciting, in my opinion. AJ Styles is watching the match on the monitor backstage. One point, or very early in the match, that we get a kick out from the Boot of Doom. The announcer's doing a very good job putting over Gallows and Anderson's time in Japan, being the IWGP tag champions. Ultimately, the Usos win after a double super kick to Gallows, and you see AJ looking frustrated. The way they're setting this up, it makes it seem like the club might be reuniting, and I'm really all for that, because right now, especially with AJ and Gallows and Anderson both kind of floating in the ether in their own way, especially the Good Brothers, putting them all back together I think would be really good for them. They show us a Twitter video of Hulk Hogan cutting a promo on the Women's World Cup. It's a very long way to go for what's essentially a very subtle plug for Fox programming at the very end of the bit. Roman Reigns then makes his way out to the ring. He calls out Shane McMahon from the get-go. Shane appears on the big screen from his VIP lounge and says, no, he's the best in the world. The way he says it is pretty funny, pretty smarmy stuff. He then tosses it over to Drew, who cuts another promo on Roman. He's talking about physical assault, physical disfigurement. He wants Roman's children to scream at the sight of their father after he just like beats his face into a bloody pulp. And that's all Roman needs to hear. He gets out of the ring, goes to the crowd, and makes his way toward the VIP lounge. He beats the hell out of the Revival on the outside. He gets his hands on Shane for a moment, but then Drew gets his hands on him. He puts Drew through the hummus table, and he chases Shane McMahon down the hallway, through the crowd, into the ringside area, and just proceeds to beat the hell out of him with the spear and the Superman punch and all that stuff. So it's kind of nice to see Roman getting a one-up on Shane after what happened at Super Showdown. And that's pretty much that. Part of me thinks this whole thing would have been a lot more impactful if, you know, Roman just crashed the party, uninvited, unannounced, no warning, and just did his thing there, kind of, and then resumed basically where the rest of the segment continued. You know, it reminded me in a lot of ways of this, the episode where Vince is in the hospital back in 1998, when Vince is beat up, he's in the hospital and Mankind's entertaining with Mr. Sacco and all that stuff. As that was going on, concurrently, they were constantly plugging Steve Austin was going to be there to give his side of the story. And so they kept plugging it and plugging it. And finally, that whole hospital stuff ends with Austin in disguise as a doctor beating up Vince with the bedpan, all that stuff. It's a very classic scene. But that's kind of how they set that up, was the idea that Austin was going to be in the arena and then he wasn't. And then at the end, JR on commentary says, that was Austin's side of the story. So, you know, I saw a lot of parallels with that. The way they were showing Shane the VIP lounge, they were plugging Roman Reigns for later. I thought it would have been funny if they just had like a bunch of like catering people come in to change out the food and everything, and like Roman's disguised as one of the catering people and he just tears off his catering vest to reveal his flak vest. But that's kind of a nitpick. On the whole, I really enjoyed these segments with Shane and the VIP lounge and the heels beating up Heath Slater and all that stuff, and Roman eventually coming in. It's nice to see the Revival getting this really big rub from being associated with Shane, being the Raw Tag Team Champions and all that. And you know, I just love Shane's heel work. He is so good in this role, as frustrating as it is. I wish they put this kind of effort into having a really awesome heel that was not a McMahon or a relation to a McMahon. Backstage, Bayley, Naomi, and Natalya are giggling about something when Charlie Caruso walks in and asks Bayley what she thinks about all of these rumors being lobbed against her about how she's really mean to fans and so on. And for the second week in a row, Bayley does not directly deny those allegations. She just says, oh, this has got Alexa Bliss's fingerprints all over it, but never says, no, that's not me. I like my fans. I'm not what they say I am. End of story. So 2 weeks in a row, she does that, which to me almost seems like a tell or a clue that, oh my God, maybe Alexa Bliss is in the right about this. Maybe finally what she's saying about people is proven to be true. And maybe we're going to see a double turn. It may not happen this Sunday, but mark my words, I'm calling it right now. My bold declaration, my bold statement and prediction, we will see a Bayley and Alexa Bliss double turn, because Alexa will be redeemed, having been proven right and being proven that Bayley is actually a terrible person like she says that she is. I mean, can you imagine? Women's tag title match up next as the Iconics defend against Alexa Bliss and Nikki Cross. The Iconics also make an LA Lakers reference in their pre-match promo. It's a pretty good match. You see Bayley on the outside, ringside, watching the action. She gets into it with Alexa on the outside, and that allows the Iconics to pin Nikki Cross to retain the championships. And wow, the Iconics wrestling twice on TV in the span of 7 days. That's amazing. Backstage after the match, Nikki Cross is convinced that Bayley is the crusher of dreams, and she says she will be in Alexa's corner on Sunday to make sure Bayley doesn't do something sneaky again. Michael Cole seems way too giddy when introducing the Firefly Funhouse for the week. He's like, hey, this is a pretty wacky stuff, gang. Firefly Funhouse. Then we get the creepiest shit in the history of this segment happening, where Bray, and that metamorphosis from Bray to the Fiend, finally appears to be complete, because he's got his bit with the puppets. It goes black and you see all this crazy imagery and like very big jump cuts and everything, and different like musical versions of the Muscle Man dance song. And then you see the Fiend finally show up in his full form. It says, let me in. And that's pretty much where it ends, this huge kind of cliffhanger thing. All the puppets are like down. Have they been killed by the Fiend? We don't really know for sure. But yeah, that was definitely the most powerful Firefly Funhouse we have seen in this entire series. It seems to be the logical end to the saga we've seen so far. Hate to see it go, but it ends on a really high note if that's the case. I'm really excited now. And I know like people have said, like, this Firefly Funhouse thing is really interesting, but it doesn't make me want to see him wrestle. Some have said that, and I'm kind of in that boat as well. But after seeing this, I'm really excited to see what Bray Wyatt / The Fiend will do when he's finally in a live audience. We get another really good promo by Daniel Bryan in the gorilla position, his second one of the night. Then we go to our main event, where he takes on Seth Rollins in non-title action. The commentary brings up the fact that Seth has never beaten Daniel in one-on-one action. I honestly can't remember the last time these two had a one-on-one match, if I'm being honest. I'm sure some of you will let me know in the comments section. But anyway, early in the match, Rowan interferes, the match is thrown out, out come the New Day, KO and Zayn, the Revival, the Usos, they're all rolling out here, and it's a big old brawl. Eventually, the faces take out all the baddies, and the match is restarted with everyone, all the side characters all ushered to the back, and they get a lot of time in this one, Seth and Daniel. It's a great match, ultimately ends with Seth beating Daniel with the Stomp. bump to close out the match there. As he's celebrating on the ramp, he's beat up from behind by Baron Corbin with the chair. He's just clubbered. Finally, turnabout's fair play. So Baron's just beating the hell out of Seth with the chair. End of days in the ring. So a nice bit of a turnaround from what happened when he lost the match, the 2 out of 3 falls match against the New Day, clean as a whistle. He ends up on top here against Seth Rollins. So it's a nice kind of make good for what happened earlier. The New Day opens SmackDown this week. Big E pitches his idea for the Freaky Hour when suddenly Dolph Ziggler interrupts, cuts a big promo on Kofi, saying the next time he goes to Ghana, it'll be an apology tour for letting everyone there down after Dolph beats him at Stomping Grounds. Then Kofi has a retort for Dolph, says he'll beat him in the cage on Sunday. Dolph closes up the promo strong, and then we have our match where Dolph takes on Xavier Woods in one-on-one action. It's a very good match between the two. Kevin and Sammy get involved early on, and then the rest of the New Day are ejected. Woods is beaten down and super kicked while tied up in the ropes. So Ziggler wins pretty emphatically here. So yeah, it's a very strong opening match and really makes Dolph look a killer. Backstage, Shelton Benjamin and the B team are lined up outside Baron Corbin's dressing room. We never see him on this show, by the way, but his door is there. And they're all wanting to lobby to him about being guest referee for Stomping Grounds. Matt Hardy walks out of the locker room and refers to Shelton as Senior Benjamin. I get that reference. It's time for a moment of bliss with special guest Bayley. Second verse, same as the first. Only this time she has stolen Alexa's coffee from backstage, and these two really get into it. Bayley warns Nikki Cross that Alexa's just using her like she used Nia Jax and Mickie James. Alexa says that even all the way back in the NXT days, she could see through Bayley. And for the supposed nice one, she was really kind of dogging Alexa just as much as everyone else was, calls Bayley a liar. And Bayley at one point says in the promo she's never needed anyone else to succeed. A bit of the shade, it seems, thrown at Sasha Banks there in that line. Alexa says that Bayley peaked in NXT and that she can't stand the fact that the one woman she can't stand, that being Alexa, has had more of a successful career in the main roster than Bayley's ever had. They has fight. Nikki breaks it up, and then in that confusion, Alexa takes Bayley out with a forearm shot. And that's pretty much that. This is probably one of the better moments of bliss we have seen in the history of that show since the debut at the beginning of the year, where every segment has some kind of wacky interruption. This one's probably the most serious one they've done, and I give them props for that one. I'm glad they used NXT as a reference for a reference point to their animosity. It's more of that she said stuff, but for the first time, which kind of contradicts what I said just a few moments ago on Raw, that Bayley for the first time finally actually denies some of these accusations against her by Alexa Bliss. Although really, who knows what's real anymore? And I'm still very excited to see just what happens between these two at Stomping Grounds. Backstage, Apollo Crews approaches Zelina Vega and tries to find out where Andrade is, and Zelina stalls until Andrade hits him and beats him up from behind, and then they leave. In the background, you see old there, short-haired Chad Gable still taking those notes on Apollo Crews. Oh, what could those notes be about? The mind boggles. The B team take on Heavy Machinery up next. Daniel Bryan and Rowan are on commentary. Heavy Machinery come out with their bushwhacker walk, and Daniel says they should try and emulate the sheep herders, not the bushwhackers. That's a good point. Heavy Machinery went handily after hitting the compactor. Seth Rollins shows up and beats the bejesus out of the B team with a steel chair for trying to side with Corbin earlier in the night. Shane McMahon then arrives outside the arena. He's approached by Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn, and then they say Shane has a problem with both of his champions, not just Kofi, but Kofi and Seth. So Shane makes a match for later in the night, another 2 out of 3 falls tag match, as Kevin and Sami take on Kofi and Seth. So we're just going to copy what Raw did then? We get another Aleister Black promo. He says when he finally has an opponent to fight, he will change that man's essence. So he's going to try and make him come? Shane McMahon, Elias, and Drew McIntyre make their way to the ring. Drew cuts a promo on Roman again before The Miz interrupts. How far along are we on that 4 count for the wild card rule tonight, by the way? The Miz plays clips from Roman's beatdown on Shane the night before, and Miz says he feels guilty that he's created a monster in Shane McMahon. If he wasn't injured at the World Cup tournament, Shane wouldn't have taken his place, wouldn't have been named best in the world, and wouldn't be on this massive ego trip that has encapsulated both Raw and SmackDown as of right now. And so Shane makes a tag team match for The Miz against Elias and Drew, but says you have to find a tag team partner in the next 10 seconds. And as the 10 seconds goes down, R-Truth magically appears from under the ring, and there's some confusion for a minute, and then Miz goes, okay, awesome, Truth reunited, and here we go. Before we get that match, though, backstage, you see the Iconics walking through the hallway. They see the Kabuki Warriors. Holy shit, haven't seen them in forever and a day. Paige tells Billy and Peyton that next week in Tokyo, these two teams will have a match, and if the Kabuki Warriors win, then they'll have a shot at the women's tag titles later. Why not just have the tag title match in Tokyo? So the Awesome Truth is reunited for the first time in many years, taking on Drew McIntyre and Elias. It is an elimination tag team match, by the way. That was added. That stipulation was added just before the match began. Truth is eliminated by Elias, sending the jobbers. We get some mass confusion on the outside with all the 24/7 title contenders before R-Truth grabs the belt and runs off and escapes again for the time being. Miz fights valiantly against Elias, but ultimately Drew really inserts himself into the match pretty heavily with a Glasgow kiss and a claymore to win. Two more claymores afterwards, so Drew can send a message to Roman. You know, I said it once before, I'll say it again. Really hard for me to get behind The Miz as a babyface when he keeps on losing to Shane and or his cronies. You know, I didn't feel so bad when he was the one taking the final pinfall in that Fatal 5-Way on Raw, because at least, even though he lost, and it's not good for his character, at least it wasn't just someone of that ilk. Backstage, Ember Moon confronts Mandy Rose and Sonya Deville over what happened last week with her beloved Nintendo Switch. Ember knocks the donuts out of Mandy and Sonya's hands, and they scrap for a bit before they're ultimately separated. You know, I still find it interesting. They waited a whole week for Ember to do something about this when there was a perfectly good opportunity to at least cause some kind of distraction in the match they were involved in last week after their incident prior. Outside, R-Truth tries to escape the arena, but he's jumped by Drake Maverick disguised as Carmella, complete with falsies. He rolls up Truth from behind and wins the 24/7 championship, jumps in the referee's car, and drives off. What a really entertaining bit this was. Main event time, 2 out of 3 falls match as Kofi Kingston and Seth Rollins take on Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn. Kofi wins the first fall instantly after hitting Sami with the Trouble in Paradise. A few more minutes pass and Seth hits the stomp on KO to win the second straight fall, so it's another uncontested sweep of a victory for the good guys here. You know, I mean, it was a good, it was an okay match, good action and everything, but are we really going to have two of these 2 out of 3 fall matches, 2 nights in a row, that both have very similar booking? Time now for me to decide which show won for the week, Raw or SmackDown. This week, I'm going to go with Raw as the winner. I think this is honestly one of the best episodes of Raw I've seen in a long time. So much character development, so much exposure for so many different people. People you wouldn't even expect got some time to shine on the show on Monday. Lots of quality matches. Even the shorter matches still packed a lot of punch, like the Usos, Gallows-Anderson tag team match, for example. Nice job taking some direct tutorial risks with some of the camera shots they did. Don't think I didn't notice that stuff with a big pan going through the backstage area to Shane's VIP lounge, or the establishing shot of the trainer's room. Like, again, it's these little small, you know, these small aesthetic changes that I think just make it feel different than the usual monotonous formula we've seen for so long now. Like, just any kind of difference like that is, to me, very noticeable. Yet, oddly enough, I missed the aesthetic changes of the third hour for those last couple weeks a while back. But the camera stuff really resonates with me more. So that was really cool as well. SmackDown was strong too, don't get me wrong, but I think that a lot of the same issues that came up with me last week reared their ugly heads yet again this time around. And also, it's good to try different new things, but when you try and do the same thing Raw just did with, like, here's another 2 out of 3 falls match, here's a match that has a big schmoz early on and then guys are rejected and the match continues. Like, don't do the same thing Raw did the next night. That just doesn't jive well with me. Let me know what you thought about Raw and SmackDown this week in the comments section below, and be sure to vote which show you thought was better by going to the iCard in the upper right hand corner of your screen. Stay tuned for later this week when I give you my predictions for Stomping Grounds for Sunday. I'm Brian Zane, and I'll see you next time.